don't you cry no more. are back on a Monday. Let me change my camera here. Hopefully everything's still working. Oh, the R9 still wants to go. I guess you guys were expecting to see another guitar in my hands, but we'll get to that. We will. I'm not gonna troll you and tell you I've got a new guitar and not have one. All right, let me see what I'm gonna do here first. That's all going good. That's going. Let's see what's going on with this thing. Do this, and I can do that. Make sure we're live. Yep. All right, let me put this away for a second. And all right, we're back in business on a Monday Night Raw, episode number 40. Can you believe it, guys? December already, and we're rolling. All right, let's see if this mic is going. It seems to be working. And we've already got a bunch of people in here already. 29 people already in here. Wow. Look at that. It's going to be a long list of people here. Anyway, we got a busy show. I've got some stuff to show you. Let me see if I can pause this preview. Maybe not. I have no idea. I'm using this new streaming. Well, it's not new streaming. It's the new YouTube interface, the YouTube studio, and it's a little bit different than what I'm used to. I wish I could go back to the old one because I like the old one a lot better. But you know what they say, you got to do what you got to do. So let me go to this. There we go. All right. Everybody got my bearings, played my song. Everybody's in. Let's get started. We got Ben Coombs in the house. How are you, Ben? Nice to see you. Oregon Steve. Lovely. You got this. You're getting a chance to see it live. That's awesome. Usually you watch the replay because I know you're usually at work or something. That's cool. Brad Egan, how's it going, man? Long time no see. Hope Ottawa's treating you well. I know you were, I think, in the process of building a house or something, so I hope that's going well for you. We got hit with a storm yesterday. Your guys are probably getting it, or you probably got it too late last night. But yeah, we got some shitty weather yesterday. But hopefully that's gone eastbound now, so we're out of the bulk of it. Joe Hervey, what's going on, man? I saw Ben in there. There's Janice. Janice is going to be driving. Well, that's okay. You can still listen, Janice. We'll still entertain you while you're driving, let's say. Let's put it that way. Alex Radford, how is it going, brother? California, right? Looking forward to being in California in January for NAMM, and that's coming up real quick. Real quick. We were already in December, so we're only about a month away from that. So lots of stuff to look forward to and get ready for. 131, how's it going? I never saw that name, but welcome. Glad to see you in here. Everything's still working on my end. That's good. Brian Stewart, what's going on? You got a new guitar today as well, did you? I think I saw something on Facebook. You got their delivery. Looks like a PRS. And looking forward to seeing that. DR's Guitars, how's it going, man? Nice to see you. Always enjoy Brian S. and Dave, Dr. Guitar's show, The Live Wires. It happens on Wednesdays at 9 o'clock Eastern. I believe it's 6 o'clock West Coast time, I believe. Music Therapy Lads, what's up, man? Nice to see you. Guitar Hack, what's going on, man? See you recovered from your gig on the weekend. Glad to see that I know you're super busy with those gigs, man. That's good stuff. If you enjoy that, keep going. I did it for so many years. I don't know if I could do it again. Not at that level. I mean, doing the bar stuff. I probably join a band, but I don't think I'd do the whole, you know, the small pubs and stuff like that. I think I'd rather either join a big tribute band of some sort and do just a few festivals and a few gigs a year. Nothing more than that. Every weekend thing for me is pretty much done. But, hey, do it while you still can, brother. All the power to you. R2, R3, what's going on? Hope you're still playing your Les Paul. I know you were looking at, I think you were looking at an Ibanez or something that I saw in one of the chats that you were in. You seem to like those smaller neck guitars. 6 strings and 10 fingers. How are you, brother? That's a long-ass name. That's one thing with these names sometimes when I'm on my iPad. You can't do the tagging, so you got to type everything in, and it's just like, holy shit. it's a process. Gary Tholander, what's going on, brother? And let's see who else we got in here. Brad Miller, you're almost home. That's good. Get home safely. I know there's no bad weather in, well, sometimes there's bad weather in Florida, I guess, but not winter weather. Let me see. Marco's Images, how are you? Nice to see you. If you got any questions as well during the night or during our show here in the next hour, make sure you tag me in there because I'll be able to see that in the chat easily and I'll get to it. Brian S. R9. You didn't get an R9. I know you didn't get an R9 because you posted something about a PRS, so I'm going with that. All right, I'm almost down to the bottom here. Paul Liu, how's it going, Paul? Nice to see you jumping in here. We got a great, great bunch of people in here tonight, so if you have any questions, I'm sure if I can't answer them, somebody in this chat will be able to do that, no problem. R2 says, I got solo, Brian. Okay. Lars Guitars. Hey, Brian and everyone. Metal Soda. There's Metal. Metal Soda. Changed his name again. I like Metal Soda better than Soda and Milk. Metal Soda's better. All right. Let me see. Terry's G&G. Chicken Guitars. How are you, man? Man. Ma'am. Can I call you ma'am? Yeah, she's going to hit me when she sees me. That's okay. I hope you're doing well. David Ennis is in here too. My God, we've got a ton of people. Thrash Metal, play some Slayer. Yeah, we're going to talk about Slayer a little bit there in a few minutes, actually. But no, I didn't play Slayer tonight. I will attempt it someday. I used to play a lot of stuff from Seasons in the Abyss when I was, I used to play in a thrash metal band back in the early 90s, and we covered a lot of that album. So, as a bass player, obviously, I never really played it on guitar too much. But, it's all good. It's all good. Let's see. Can't see the chat. Unfortunately, can't see the chattered guitar, but we will reward later when... Oh, yeah, you can definitely check it on the replay. It'll be there, unless it gets taken down for some reason, because I played Kansas. Who knows, right? Do it till you drop, Guitar Hack. Attaboy. That's the spirit. All right, I think I've got... Livewire says they've got Lars Guitars on Wednesday and Tone King next week. Cool. Yeah, that'll be fun. Play Smeer. Yeah, I should play some Smeer sometimes. I got some information regarding Smeer, actually, that I got a phone call on the weekend. Somebody asking about a festival that they want me to attend this summer, and it has something to do with Smeer, not the whole band, because the whole band's not together anymore. But I've gotten a little interesting offer thrown my way, so... I might do that. Once I know a little bit more, I'll let you guys in on it. All right, I think I'm down here. If I missed anybody, I'm terribly sorry. I'm trying to keep up with this chat. There's a ton of people in here tonight. Terry says, new guitar bought on deals on the weekend. Yeah, I went to the Black Friday thing in order to do this deal, and good Lord. Not a place you want to be on a Black Friday, I'll tell you, at one of these music stores where they're having these huge sales, because it was insane. But had to be done. Dale Palmer, what's going on? Nice to see you, Dale. Hope you're feeling better. All right. I think we've got everybody. We've got everybody in here, so yeah. All right, let's get to some news real quick, and then we'll get to what everybody wants to see, that everybody that's in here anyway, most of you want to see this purchase. So let me go to my thing here and that. And we'll do a few. I just got a few little news stories real quick, I promise, nothing crazy. And then we'll move on. Alrighty. Hold on 1 second. Do this, do that, and that works. All right. Well, everything is working. So I guess I've only got a few stories today, or tonight, I should say. So we always do a this day in rock history or music history. So back in 1976, on this day, December 2nd, Pink Floyd, this was an interesting story I found. It's not like super crazy, but it was kind of interesting. It was the first day of their photo shoot for their forthcoming album, Animals. And if you guys remember the cover of that album, it had a big inflated, I guess, pig or something of that nature. And so what happened was, the interesting story about that whole thing was that they had hired a trained marksman in order to shoot the pig in case it basically, because it was on these, I guess, cables or whatever to hold it to stop, because it was huge. I mean, this thing was huge, so it would have flew away, right? So they needed to hire a marksman in case the cables or something let go, that he could shoot this inflatable pig so that, you know, it wouldn't fly away and, you know, hurt somebody or whatever, you know, whatever could happen at that point. So they hired this marksman on the day one of the photo shoot. Everything went fine. The pig did not escape or did not get free of the ropes or whatever it was. But they had a second day basically booked, and they needed to do a second day of photo shoots in order to get the photos, I guess. But the following day, they didn't have budget to hire the marksman, so they didn't hire the marksman. And of course, that day, the cables broke on the inflatable pig, and the inflatable pig flew off, uncontrollable, so they was just gone. And it was picked up many, many miles down the road, or, you know, in that, wherever they were in England. And it landed in a farmer's field. And I guess the farmer was pretty furious because it landed among a bunch of cows and stuff. And the cows were all freaking out, running around. And so they freaked out the farmer's cow. So it didn't land in a highway or something like that, which would have been interesting. So I just saw this story, and I thought it was kind of funny that they hired a marksman basically to shoot the stupid inflatable in order to stop it from flying away if it ever did. But so that's story number one. And our story number two, of course, we spoke a little bit here about Slayer, and this is basically, I said the other week, a few weeks ago, about these farewell tours and stuff, and now Motley Crue's basically announced they're going to go back on tour after, you know, a few years ago when they said they were done touring and they did their final tour and they signed a contract and now they're back. And I said back then a few weeks ago that, you know, I'm not believing any more bands that say this is their final show and the final, you know, contracts and all that stuff. But with Slayer, I tend to believe it a little bit more because these guys, you know, Tom Araya is really, you know, I mean, anything can happen, but I tend to believe these guys more than some other bands that have been out there and did the whole, you know, farewell tour. But anyway, they played their last show on Saturday night in, I think it was in Inglewood, California, at the Forum. And they played, I believe, 20 songs. Their final song was Angel of Death. Here's the full set list here. So Angel of Death was the last song. And after the last song, they spent about 10 minutes on stage. You know, they took some pictures and Tom, and then everybody left, and Tom Araya stayed on the stage. And all he did was basically walk from one end to the stage to the other and just stopped at different points and just looked out in the crowd. And the crowd was going insane, obviously. And he was quite emotional about the whole experience, looking out there. You know, he spent the last 30 years of his life doing this, and this was essentially the last show, and that's why I tend to more believe him. And the thing with Tom is that he's had issues with health in the last couple of years, and he had neck problems, and, you know, things were, and Slayer is not easy. Like, it's, you're at a Slayer show, it's quite physical, and you know, it's pretty intense. So I think that he's gotten to the point where it's time, and he needed to call it a day. But anyway, he stood, if you guys get a chance, you can watch the video, it's on YouTube, and that they show us the end, the last song, and it shows Tom, and basically he's just, you know, standing there taking it all in, and then he goes up to the mic and says thank you to the crowd, and says, you know, thank you for your time, and time is so important in our lives, and that he really was appreciative of the fans that have taken the time to buy their albums, to listen to their music, to come out to shows, and all this stuff, all throughout their whole career they've done this. And and he basically said thank you to the fans, and, you know, said thank you for being part of my life, and he walked off. It was pretty emotional. So if you guys get a chance to see that, just do a Google search, or just a YouTube search, and you'll see the video there. But yeah, that was their last concert, and it was sold out. Does it say how many people? Well, it was sold out at the Forum. So how many, maybe 30,000 people there at their last show. So pretty cool. Another band calls it a day. I wasn't a huge Slayer fan. I mean, I liked some of the stuff, and some of the stuff was, you know, it's pretty intense, right? But like I said, I did play it, and I played in some bands that covered some of their material and did some of that stuff. So I total respect to that band, total respect. All right, so let's go back to camera here, and let me get rid of this. All right, cool. Okay, let me go back to the chat real quick. We're almost at the 7:23, almost getting down to the half hour mark. Make sure I didn't miss anything here in the chat, and we'll get going to our main event. and I'm telling you right now, some of you guys are going to be pretty shocked what it actually ends up being, because I've had a couple of people message me, private message and stuff through Facebook and everything, that know that I was out on Friday and went shopping and for that guitar and did a deal and everything, and everybody seems to know what it is, or think they know what it is, and nobody's gotten it right yet, so we'll see. All right, let me see. Dale says, ever go cow tipping? No, I never did. I never did. I've had the opportunity. I've been asked before, but I never did. Where I'm from, it's a small town, and lots of stuff happens in these small towns as a kid when you're bored. We didn't have cell phones. We didn't have the internet back then, so we had to entertain ourselves. But yeah, cow tipping, I never did. I never did. Let's see. Gary Tholander says, the power plant where they shot that album cover is being converted to high-end condos. Really? Wow. George, I seen Slayer early 2000s. Amazing. Yeah, I saw Slayer a few times. I saw them once at the Massey Hall, which is just a small theater here in Toronto, and I saw them at the exhibition place as part of the Clash of the Titans concert. It was Alice in Chains, Anthrax, Slayer, and Megadeth. That was the bill, and it was really good. Great show. All right, checking out you guys. Brian S. says, I played my final show. I signed a contract. Yeah, I hear you, brother. Ozzy's done about six. Ozzy, I don't know, man. I feel for Ozzy. I don't know how much more he's got in him. But that's all he knows. And that's, you know, if he's not playing, he's not happy. So all the power to him. Let's see. Jamal, how are you? Jamal's in here too. Kiss isn't retiring. They're dying a slow death. Oh my God. Let's see if I can. Oh God, this thing, I don't know if it's going to work. Okay, cool. All right, I'm just going to kind of go down. Hopefully, I didn't miss anybody here. Oregon Steve, You know, I'm not going to say anything just yet. Rick Hefner, I saw that tour. Oh, did you? Yeah, the Slayer one you're talking about, Rick? It was a great show. Scott Connor, what's going on? Ozzy's puppet with Sharon hand stuck, you know where? Yep, pretty much. Ever seen a cow jump a 6-foot fence? Mind blown. Oh my God. All right, let's get to it. So it's almost 7:30. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put my little lapel mic, because I'm not going to put this on that side, and I'm going to have to go to the other angle to show you the guitar, and then I'll do a switcheroony type of thing here. So just give me 1 second here that I can get all of that. Oh, Rick Hefner says Clash. Yeah, that was a pretty good tour. Great tour, actually. Is she a really big spender? I think the kids. Okay. All right. Let me see if my stream is still healthy. Yeah, it looks healthy. Everything is looking good. We've got 35 folks in here. Cool. Cool. All right, let me see if I can figure this out. So I'm just going to wear my little Rode mic here, because this will have to switch over and all that fun stuff. So this will be easier to do it this way. So the audio will change a little bit quality-wise, so forgive me about that, but it is what it is. Let's see, general, okay. All right, let me turn that on. All right, you guys should still be able to hear me. I put that on my shirt here, and I shut down this mic, so we shouldn't be hearing any echoes or anything of that nature. All right, let me switch to the back camera. I'm gonna do that. And, okay. And bring my iPad a little closer here, so I can see the chat. All right, cool. All right, let me go to this. So I'll show you the case, and you should be able to, you'll know what it's not at that point. If anybody wants to throw out some guesses in the chat, go ahead. And let me switch to that camera angle there, and I need to bring up my, where is it? This thing, I think. Like that. Okay, that works. All right, so that looks like it's working. Cool. All right. Any guesses? No, Joe Hervey, it's not a Gibson. Not a Gibson. Charvel? No, it's not a Charvel. You should be able to see on the case. Well, it's hard to see the make of the guitar. There is a label on the case there, right by the handle. But typically these cases are known by somebody. Oh, and we got Ben says it's a Fender. Could be. Let me just adjust this mic a little bit. Could be a Fender. Let's see what we got. Steinberger? No, not Steinberger. Area Pro. Yeah, pretentious Area Pro 2. I should get one of those someday. Stratton? No, not quite. Ben's got the closest guess so far. Let's see. Guitar Hack says Fender, so I think you guys, a couple of you are right on the money. It says Fender on the case. Okay, so we know it's a Fender. Let's put it that way. What is it? Is it a Strat? Is it a Jag? Is it a Tele? Is it, what else do they make? whatever else you might think. I got 61 ticket for open container. Oh, she's trash. Dale says it's a 59 Fender. No. You like my socks? Yeah, they are the Harley socks. I got to get BMW socks someday. Okay, looks like we've got a bunch of guesses here that are, some of you are right on. Brian S. says a Nags. No. Meteora. No. Jimmy Page Dragon Telecaster. Yes, it's not that one. Mustang 12. No, it's not an acoustic. Jazzmaster. Hendrix Custom Shop and Purple Metal Flake. Good Lord, Ultra Elite Professional. All right. So let's move on. Nice guesses, but those of you that guessed the Fender, you were right there. Those of you that guessed the Tele, you were right there. So this is, so here you can see, we've got a Telecaster. This is a Custom Shop Tele. This is a 51 reissue. So there we, you can see a little bit. I'm gonna switch the camera angle here, so just bear with me. Just wanted to show you the case as well, because it, you know, it's a pretty cool case. And there it is. Heavy relict, obviously. Heavy relic, and it's got some pretty cool stuff. It's got a huge neck. It's got some relicking on the back there. So, all right, let me close this case and let's change the camera angle a little bit so that you can get a better look at this. Let me pull that from there and do this. Cool. All right. And I can move that out of the way. So there it is. This is a Fender Limited Edition Custom Shop Telecaster 1951 reissue. It's got a humbucker, obviously, in the neck, and it's got a Custom Shop Tele pickup, custom wound pickup in the bridge, three-way toggle, ash body, maple neck. It's got a huge neck. I'll show you on the other camera a little bit better, but it's bigger than my Les Paul neck, let's put it that way. And so the story behind this one was I brought back the Ultra, as you all know, that I got an Ultra a few weeks ago, and I really liked it, but the neck just wasn't for me. It was just a little too small. And I really wanted like the Tele that was going to really fit me as a player and sound and everything else that I was looking to do. So I wanted something, you know, top qualities that was going to be that one Tele. So when I brought it back to Cosmo, I noticed that they had a couple of custom shops available in there. This was ordered, this is a 2019, it was right from NAMM, this summer NAMM, and they ordered it. I guess they just got them in, and they had three or four of them, and this was one of them that was there. And so I brought back the Ultra. They gave me all the money back, obviously it was within the 30-day period. So I was able to get this. And then what happened was Cosmo was having this huge Black Friday deal where everything in store was 15% off. And so this was gonna work out to be, you know, it's still a lot more expensive than the Ultra, but saved a lot of money because of the 15%. So if I was gonna do it, that was the time to do it. And I needed to get something at Cosmo, basically. I couldn't, you know, I was still really looking for that Les Paul custom, and I still am at this point, but they didn't have them at Cosmo, and I just, you know, I figured let me get the Tele and get that out of the way, and then I'll worry about the Les Paul custom later. So this is it. Let me see if I can, I'll switch the camera, I'll go back to the front, and I'll plug it in. This thing sounds incredible. I mean, it's very inspiring to play when you play something different, and it sounds amazing. I actually wrote a song this weekend. It inspired me enough that I was playing and I was getting, you know, rock sounds out of this thing like crazy. So I did some recording, and this was the main guitar I used for the new song. So really cool. So let me grab my wireless here. Hold on. Oh, sorry about that. Hit that switch so you don't hear that. All right. So right now I've got my Helix patch, which is more for my Les Pauls, but I tried it with this guitar earlier and it sounded really good. So let me, and I did make a patch on the weekend that's more geared to the Tele. Let me move a little bit this way so you can see better. Let me see. All right, let me hit the switch. So right now I'm just on the bridge. That's just the, that's using the patch that I built for the Les Paul. So then if you go to the middle position is basically both pickups, obviously. So it's a little bit beefier sound. So basically that. Then basically if you go to the, that's full humbucker. So really great sound in pickups. The pickup in the neck is actually a Seymour Duncan Set Myers or something like that. I have the book here that has all the specs in it, so I can probably tell you exactly. So they give you a cool book. They give you the builder's name. The builder's name's in there, and then the whole stat of when the guitar is built, everything that's on it. Really detailed. Actually, it's a lot more detailed than the custom shop Les Pauls that I've got. Where's the pickup? Pickup. Where is it? Set Lover is the Seymour Duncan Set Lover here in the neck, and then the Handwine Crushed Blackguard Tele pickup here. Dual stack HS. Yeah. So that bridge pickup is insanely good. I'm floored by what I'm getting out of this. Let me turn the camera. I'm gonna go to the other side and go back to my regular mic here. So just give me 1 second. It's not pink. It's basically more of a beige-ish color, like wood color. It's kind of, this camera, the color correction on it's not the best. So it's more like a little, like a blonde would be, basically a blonde telly, but faded, very faded. And the relicking on it's really cool. And the back of the neck is all relic too. So they sand it down. It's all like the Friedman necks, right? So they give you a nice, you feel the wood basically instead of that clear that usually comes on them. All right, so hold on. Let me switch this. Let me go back to my mic. All right, so let me switch this camera here. And what I want to do is I want to go on the patch that is built for the Tele, so it'll give you a real Tele sound. So let me see if I can, I want to show you the neck on it from here. I don't know if you'll see it well. Let me move this, I'll move this out of the way, hold on. So you can see that's pretty big. It's like, here you can see the color a lot better here. And some of the relicking. There it is. Yeah, it's faded blonde type of thing. It's got maple. 9.5. It's a 9.5 radius as well. So let me go to my Helix here and change the patch over to the one that I built for the Teles. And that would be right here. This is a clean sound. So you can tell it's got a lot of that. Now if you go to the middle pick. Got the humbucker. Really cool sounding pickups. So if I put on a little bit of drive, well, here's the yeah, it can do AC/DC too. It can do all kinds of stuff. It can do some twangy stuff. It can do blues. It can do rock, everything. And I'm telling you, this neck is incredible. It's so thick, though. And if you don't like big necks, then you wouldn't like this at all because it's really big. But the cool thing about it is you can just hammer on this thing, and it feels like it can take everything you do throw at it, basically rock to country to anything. Let me see if I'm missing anything. All right, Ben, we'll catch your show a little later at 8 o'clock. Remember Ben Coombs. It's against the law to play that on a Fender AC/DC. It sounds great on here, man. I'm telling you, I jammed along with some AC/DC tracks a little earlier, and I was like, oh my God, this thing sounds amazing with that. So you can make this thing sound pretty much anyway, which is why I want a Tele, because to me, Les Pauls and Teles are where my comfort is, and Teles are so versatile. And when you're recording, you'll always need that Tele because it's so versatile. And I like to stack my guitars when I'm recording. I like to put Gibson's has its own flavor. It has its own sound. It has its own character, and it goes on its own tracks, and basically it does its thing. Then I throw in the Tele on top of that, and it just fills out the sound and goes through all the spectrums of the frequencies that I'm looking for as far as a rock player. And so to me, a Tele is a must if you're a recording musician, absolutely. And my goal was to find that ultimate Tele for me, and it took me a while. And I got the Ultra, and I thought, man, this thing's amazing, but it's just there's something missing, and there was just that neck was not the thing for me. So when I went and tried this one, I'm like, man, you know, this is it, and I need to do whatever it takes to just grab it and get it over with. So that's what I did. Dale, I'm going to make you want to buy a Tele now, right? It could Nashville. Yeah, that's why I'm moving to Nashville soon, so I needed a really good Tele to come with me. Just kidding. I'm not moving to Nashville. I wish I could. I would move to Nashville in a heartbeat if somebody offered it to me. But it's not happening right now. Loving this Fender kick. Yeah, chicken guitars. Big neck Tele. That's what it is. It's pretty cool. Let's have another quick look before I put it away. There it is. Kind of hard to show you, but I figured this camera thing is probably better color wise. It gives me a more accurate look at what the color is. There's the neck. I don't know if it's going to focus on the neck or not. It's kind of weird. But yeah. And there's the headstock. Man, this thing doesn't run out of focus. It's got the cool tuners on it. They're not locking tuners, they're vintage tuners, but they work very, very well. It's super tight on them, so. I should let you play the Roycaster. It has a neck like a... Yeah, well, I don't know. I wasn't like that when I got back into music and I was getting... You know, playing guitar instead of bass, I figured the smaller necks would be the thing that I would like more. But I guess it makes sense since I've played bass all my life, and basses, you know, have bigger necks than guitars, and it's what I've always been accustomed to. And I just figured guitar would be a little different. But as I got to playing again, and during the first year that I was playing, I started to notice that I was buying guitars that had smaller necks, but then when I would try one that would have a thicker neck just for fun, I would feel more comfortable with it. And I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. And I think this is the way I want to go. So eventually all the guitars that I had that had small necks on it started to go. Basically, I was either selling them or trading them or whatever it was. And everything that I was replacing those guitars with all had a nice, you know, bigger, thicker neck on them. And that's just where my comfort zone is. So it took me a while to figure out, you know, like anything, when you get into something again. And like I said, I know what I like for bass guitars because I've played bass, you know, for 30 years or whatever it was. But guitars, I picked them up here and there, and I wrote a few riffs and stuff. I wrote songs on them and never really spent a whole, you know, a ton of time with them as far as being a guitar player. So getting into it at the level that I'm getting into it now, I started to discover what I really liked and what really, you know, felt good to me. And it's apparently it's these big necks, because these Fenders and these Les Pauls, I'm always choosing something that has a thicker neck. It's not the 60s neck, it's the 50s profile, I guess, is where I'm really sitting at. Don't drop it, Ryan. Yeah, and that's the other thing with the cool thing about relics. I've had a few relic guitars in the last couple of years, again, since getting into it. I had Friedmans that were relics. And you know what? I don't mind them. I like them a lot. And the cool thing about a relic guitar is you pick it up and you play and you don't really think about it. You don't, you know, you're not careful with it. You just play the damn thing. It's just, you don't. My Les Pauls, I play them, and I would still play them to this day if I was playing out live or whatever. I would still play those guitars, but you're more cautious with that stuff. You tend to not want to scratch the surface, or if you are doing any wear on it, it's happening naturally. But these things, man, it's like, this is built like a tank. I'm sure I could throw this across the room and pick it up and it would still play like it. And it's not a super light guitar. It's a, you know, it's got a really thick hat. Ash body on it, and it's got some weight to it. It's not as heavy as a Les Paul. I'd say it's in the just over 7 pound range, but it's super super comfortable to play anyway. But yeah, the cool thing about relics is you don't care. You just play, and whatever happens. But when I first got into guitars again, I started going to music stores, and I would see these relics. I was completely out of music and stuff for so long that I wasn't even aware they were making guitars that were relic'd, and I didn't even know that was a thing or whatever. And when I would see somebody play a relic guitar on stage or something, I just figured it was an old guitar that they had for. So then I started to get back into it, and I noticed that was a thing. And at first I was like, why would anybody buy a guitar and spend that type of money, and the guitar looks like it's, you know, beaten up and all this stuff? So I didn't get it. And then I started, as I played more, and I started to just get more, I guess, liking them more or whatever. And then I started to see the appeal, and then I started to play them. The ones that were really, the relicking part to me is like, the neck is such a cool feature to have relic, because they wear it in and they roll the corners and the angles of them, and they're so comfortable. So I was sold at that point. But I mean, I wouldn't have all my guitars be relics. You know, I like to have, you know, nice new, like the Les Pauls that I have and stuff. But having one or two relics in my collection is totally cool. My US Strat has a thickest neck in my collection, R2 says. Yeah. 50s, I think it's the 50s Strats and Tellies have, you know, bigger necks on them. Joe says, I relic my own. There's nothing wrong with that, too. I mean, if you've got a guitar and it's been with you for many, many years and you've put that wear on it, that's totally cool. But I didn't, and I didn't buy this because of the relic. It just, I was looking for a Tele that had every feature for me that felt good, and the neck was main point of it. And when I felt this, I was like, man, this thing is exactly where I need to be. If this would have been a brand new type of like finish, not relic or whatever, and it still had this neck on it, I would have taken it as well. It's not because it's relic that I was drawn to it. It's just, this was what was there, and this is what I played, and it felt perfect. And having that humbucker in the neck for me, I think, is even, you know, I don't mind the standard Tele stuff. Like I have this Sur back there that has a lipstick pickup in the neck, and it's a Tele. It's basically cool and it plays well and there's no problem. You get that sound. But with having this humbucker, for some reason, it changed a whole lot. Like, it was, wow, this is a totally different feel. And the stuff that I play anyway is probably better adapted to have that in the neck than having that lipstick pickup in the neck, because I can do pretty much all that stuff that I'm into rock and roll-wise and blues-wise with that combination. So it works out well. Don't scratch that guitar with your belt buckle. No. No, I wouldn't be if I was playing live, I would play this guitar all night, man. I wouldn't care. It would be awesome. Telecasters are like old jeans. They feel right. Maurice Dilbert. Yes, absolutely. I agree. Don't throw it, Brian. Drop test it. Well, I'm sure that this guitar, and I love Les Paul. Les Pauls are my favorite guitars in the world, and it's still the case. But I'm telling you right now, if I had this guitar and a Les Paul side by side and I dropped them both, I think this one would live more than the Les Paul. Let's put it that way. It's built like a tank. It really is. Let's see. I'm just going down the chat. We're at 7:56. Wow. We're moving along, folks. Moving along. We're almost done episode 40. I can't believe I did 40 of these episodes already. We're in December. Man, time is just flying. I started live streaming Monday night shows in middle of February, I think, is when I started. I have to go back in my on my channel to see the history and see what the date was where my first Monday night live show was. But I believe it was middle of February or somewhere around that time. So I've only missed a few. And so 40 episodes. I was going to do a giveaway tonight, but because I was doing the guitar reveal and there was other stuff on the schedule, just didn't work out. But in the next couple of weeks, I'm planning to do a giveaway just to celebrate getting this far into the year and having done over 40 shows at that point. So I'll think of something to give away. It won't be an R9, so don't get all excited there. But definitely find something interesting and we'll have a cool little game like we did when I think I did a giveaway at episode 20, I believe. I gave away a pedal and Brad Miller had ended up winning that. So we will think of something to give away and, you know, give back to the community. Les Paul headstocks break. Yep. A metal soda. Yeah. It's unfortunate that that's just the way it is with Les Pauls, but you know, just don't drop them. 10 weeks equals 50. Yeah. DR guitars. Yeah. Congrats on 40. Congrats on 40. Thanks, man. Friedman guitar giveaway. No, I don't have a Friedman anymore. I do not have a Friedman anymore. The only guitars I have right now are what you see here in this room. There's two Les Pauls. I've got this Fender Tele. I've got a Sir Tele. And I think the Sir Tele, here's where I'm sitting with the Sir Tele, because I'm still very much in the market for a Gibson Les Paul custom black with white binding. And I've got a few on the radar here in my area and a couple in Montreal that are, you know, they're willing to deal and they're pretty much, you know, willing to negotiate a little bit on their prices. And they're fairly priced. They're not like overly priced like I've seen some on Reverb and stuff. So I'm still very much on the hunt for one of those. Now, whether this happens before the end of the year, I don't know. But what will have to probably happen at that point, if I do hit the trigger on that Les Paul custom, is probably the Sir Tele will have to go. So at that point, I'll be ending up with three Les Pauls, the custom, the R9, the R6, and this custom shop Tele, and then my bass, obviously. And that will probably be the guitars I have for a while moving forward. I think that'll give me everything that I need as far as recording wise and just, you know, that I enjoy playing, that really inspire me to play anyway, is those guitars. So look for that coming up soon, unless something changes that I get an opportunity to get something and not have to, you know, give something away or sell something or trade something. I'd like to keep them all, but unfortunately, you know, I'm at that stage where, you know, you guys know, sometimes you want a new guitar or something you really want, but you have to get rid of something else because it's the only way you can make it happen. So, well, you got to do what you got to do. And I have no regrets, right? So, yeah. Metal Soda says, bye bye, Mr. Sir Tele, for sure. Hey, James Severin. There it is, James. You missed the reveal, but I'll show it to you. It's a Fender Custom Shop Tele. It's a 1951 reissue. And if you watch a replay, you'll see more details about it and some playing and stuff with it. So, Bobby Lopez, what's going on? Jimmy Page double neck, Brian. No, not a Jimmy Page guy as far as double necks go. Brad Egan says, I haven't found a single decently priced guitar and reverb, but I also play left hand. Yeah, if you're a left-handed player, right, you're going to have limit. Well, less, I guess, options than you would being right-handed. But I'm sure there's some out there, right? Anyway, folks, I didn't follow the chat as good as I wish I would have, and I probably missed a bunch of your questions. I'm super sorry, but we were looking at guitars. We were talking about what was going on here. And I'm sure I always look back at the chat after next day or whatever, and if there's anything in there that I missed that I can respond to somebody private message or whatever, I will do that. So 8 o'clock, we've hit another cool show that we've done here, number 40. So I want to wish you guys a great week, and thank you very much for joining me every Monday night. It's always a pleasure to be up in, here and doing some talking about guitars and gear and music and, you know, just hanging out and having some fun. So hope you you enjoyed this, and hope you get a chance to play some guitar this week, and had a great Thanksgiving, all you American folks out there. I know that Thanksgiving was last week, so hope you guys had a great holiday. Christmas is just around the corner, so I'm sure it's going to be a busy time for a lot of folks. So definitely, you know, be safe out there in this crazy weather that some of us are having, and check out all the other shows that a lot of us in the community put on. I know the Guitar Hack is usually, I think, Guitar Hack just posted here. He's having a show on Thursday night with a special guest. Awesome. So Thursday night, 8 p.m. Phil Mosley is going to be on at 9 tonight. Ben has already started his show, so definitely jump in there. And I'm sure there's a bunch of other shows that we see each other and we talk on other chats during the week, which is awesome. So thanks again, folks, for always supporting me and, you know, hanging out. And, you know, if I didn't have you guys to talk about this stuff with, I would have probably nobody, because my wife can only listen to me talk about guitars for so long, and then she's out. So thank you very much, folks. With that, I think we will call it a night. So let me just do this and do this. Until next time, folks, if I do stream this week, you will get a notification, obviously, and you're welcome to jump in and we'll have some more fun. Other than that, have a great week, folks. All right, we'll catch you next time. Take care.